Okay. So good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Ratema and will be moderating the session for the day. Next slide, please. Before we begin the session, I would like to introduce GeneEvolve. GeneEvolve is the new genetic testing division of Dr. Lal Path Labs with a focused foray into the genetic testing. With the advent of this division, all of you can now expect many revolutionary and path-breaking novel tests leveraging the latest technologies, resulting in faster turnaround time and quality reports at the most affordable prices for your patients. GeneEvolve offers a wide range of key tests related to oncogenomics, neurogenomics, rare diseases, pre- and postnatal genetic testing using cutting-edge technologies such as next-generation sequencing, MLPA, ddPCR, FISH, and Sanger sequencing. All these technologies are being performed in-house at our National Reference Lab in Delhi. Next slide. As we all are aware, the genomic space is dynamically changing, and to keep up with the pace and remain the market leader, we wish to take the genetic testing from biology to health and from health to society. This is a snapshot of our core technical team of National Reference Lab, which includes Dr. Atul. He is heading the molecular department and performing tests like exomes, SCAR, neuromuscular disorders. Dr. Rajiv, who is our histo head. Dr. Anand, who is our oncopath head. Dr. Saurabh, who heads the cytogenetics department and performs microarray. And Dr. Bina, who is handling the flow department. Next slide. I would like to introduce our speakers of the session at a go, and they should not, so that there is no interruption in between. Our first speaker is Dr. Archana Lal, who is the founder director of GeneCode, Mountain View, CA, and she has been setting up the human and animal cells for genetic and genomic testing. She is a non-executive board member of Dr. Lal Path Labs. The second speaker is Dr. Amit Verma, who needs no introduction. He is the senior consultant for Max Super Speciality Hospital. Now let's move to the academic treat by Dr. Archana. Question and answers can be typed in the chat box and will be taken at the end of the session. Over to Dr. Archana.
Is my screen visible?
Not yet, ma'am.
Is it visible now?
Yes.
Well, good evening, everyone. I am Archana Lal Erdman. I am a consultant geneticist and pathologist with Dr. Lal Path Labs. Thank you for joining us for the webinar today, and we hope it provides all of you new insights into CUP and immunotherapy. The agenda for today is that it'll be divided into three sections. I will start by briefly going over our Caris molecular profiling test offered. Dr. Amit will then take over for the CUP and PD-L1 part of the talk. And in the final part of the talk, I will be speaking on tumor mutational burden in detail, along with immunotherapy modalities for CUP, finally ending with mutational signatures and the role of immunotherapy in CUP. We offer the Caris Molecular Intelligence Panel for solid tumors, which looks at mutations, copy number alterations, indels, and genomic signatures such as MSI and TMB using whole exome sequencing. It also looks at RNA fusions and variant transcripts using whole transcriptome sequencing. The average depth of coverage for DNA is 500x for 700 plus clinical and research genes, and it is 200x for all of the other genes. The average read count for RNA is 60 million. This combination of DNA, RNA, and genomic signature testing reveals a molecular blueprint to guide personalized, precise treatment for around 60 plus FDA-approved therapies. The Caris MSI test is actually an NGS-based test, which CARIS did by evaluating more than 7,000 target microsatellite loci. And the results from PCR of about 2,000 cases were compared across 26 different tumor types. This data has been published, and it has demonstrated that the MSI testing with the CARIS NGS platform is highly concordant with the traditional standard method of PCR testing. For its tumor mutational burden test, CARIS uses the whole exome sequencing to calculate mutational load. CARIS also participates in the standardization for TMB testing with another organization. And the details of this I will discuss later when I talk about TMB and its reporting. Microdissection is also performed to enrich DNA and RNA on the sample, and this improves success rates and the ability to detect molecular subclones present in the tumor. All of this information is gathered from the sample and is used by the CARIS in their new artificial intelligence-based assay called the GPS AI, which is the genomic prevalence score, which can be particularly helpful in CUP cases. The genomic prevalence score provides information on mutational signatures. And these mutational or molecular signatures can also provide information on tumors with an atypical presentation or those tumors that are clinically ambiguous. I will be discussing mutational signatures and this GP score in detail later on, and their role in CUP as well. I now hand over to Dr. Amit for his part of the talk. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. So I'm going to share my screen. So I hope the screen is all clear to everybody. And the title of today's webinar is How to Handle CUP. And it was a very interesting discussion we were having, what the title should be. So I asked my fellow colleague, where is the handle of the CUP, on the right side or the left side? So half of the people said right and half of the people said left. So both were right, nothing is wrong. So it is really very difficult to give this answer, how to handle the CUP. And I'm going to talk about the role of comprehensive genomic profiling in CUP and also a little bit on the gene expression profiling. So the CUP is basically, the definition of CUP is very unique. If you all understand that, carcinoma of unknown primary, a metastatic disease where we do not know where the primary site is coming from. And sometimes you also call it as occult primary tumor. And this is the few definitions which talks about the CUP actually. So let's talk about the burden of carcinoma of unknown primary, and this is quite a big burden in, according to the data what I'm showing here. Approximately 3 to 5% of all cancers accounts for CUP. And it is the 7 to 8 most frequent cancers globally, with the fourth most common cause of cancer death. And the incidence is quite high, up to 20 cases per 100,000 people per year. And if you see the graph, what I'm showing here is the incidence graph, which has gone down dramatically over the years because that we are able to identify more CUPs in terms of the primary site and they are no more labeled as CUP. But unfortunately, wherever we are able to say it is a CUP, the prognosis has not improved at all. So over the four decades, the survival has not increased. And the reason being, these cancers have a tendency of early dissemination. They are quite aggressive, and there is very unpredictability in terms of metastatic pattern. And they definitely carry poor prognosis. A CUP can be classified into two broad categories, the poor prognosis category and the favorable prognosis category. Majority of the CUP lie in the poor prognosis category, where the median survival range is between 8 to 12 months. In terms of the favorable subcategory, the survival can go up to 3 years, but this is a very small subset, less than 20%. So primarily we are dealing with CUP with the poor prognosis subset, which is very hard to have a better outcome. In terms of the clinical presentation or histopathological classification, we encounter 5 major subtypes of CUP. Primarily, these are the well or moderate differentiated adenocarcinomas, followed by undifferentiated or poorly differentiated carcinomas, 25%. And then squamous cell carcinomas, undifferentiated neoplasm, and carcinoma with neuroendocrine differentiation. So primarily we deal with the well, moderate, and poorly differentiated carcinomas, adenocarcinomas to be precise. In clinical setup, we do a lot of initial diagnostic workup, which includes the imaging, immunohistochemistry, and when we fail, there is no primary site which can be detected or confirmed, we go for some more detailed analysis, which includes a more panel of immunohistochemistry or detailed imaging, sometimes including upper GI or lower GI endoscopy. So the whole idea is to identify whether this patient carries favorable prognosis and we can treat them in a tailored way. ESMO has given guidelines to recognize distinct subsets of CUP. And if you see in the favorable prognosis subset, you can speculate few sites, but you do not have the evidence for them. For example, a woman with isolated axillary lymph node metastasis from adenocarcinoma, but there is no evidence of breast primary, but you tend to assume that this probably coming from the breast. So these patients who have favorable prognosis CUP subset criteria met, you can go ahead with the specific treatment and you can have a better outcome. On the other hand, patients with poor prognosis CUP subset who has overall the performance status to be poor, elevated LDH, they have a very poor survival. And patients with performance status of less than 1, but normal LDH do better. But in these cases, sometimes we tend to go for doublet chemotherapy, which includes platinum. With the very poor subset prognosis, we normally offer the best supportive care or pellet chemotherapy. So the majority of the CUP patients, as I mentioned, that they lie in the poor prognosis category with less than 1 year of median overall survival. And for the favorable category, they are responsive to chemotherapy and can have a better outcome. So this is a chart graph, Kaplan-Meier graph, talking about the survival of the poor subset category. And if you can see, after the first year, there's a sudden drop in the overall survival, and the five-year survival is approximately 10%. So it is a very difficult disease to treat. So you can consider CUP as a different entity rather than an unknown primary, because they carry a poor prognosis and they are inherently chemo resistance to begin with. ESMO guidelines also talks about giving a doublet chemotherapy for poor prognosis patients, which primarily includes platinum in their treatment options. And sometimes they can also recommend the gemcitabine irinotecan based treatment. So we have a lot of challenges of CUP in terms of diagnosis, in terms of treatment, but we also see this as an opportunity where we can do something better for them. So the idea is to find the primary site if possible and treat them in a tailored manner way where you can expect some better outcome. The other thing which we see as an opportunity is to know about the genomic alterations which are driving their cancer. And if we are able to harness that information and treat them using the personalized treatment approach of precision oncology approach, we may expect a better outcome. So these are the opportunities. And right now it is an evolving science and CUP is being investigated in a big way these days. So we have options of identifying the tumor origin by using gene expression profiling or epigenetic profiling. And this gene expression profiling or epigenetic profiling can correlate with the known tissue of origin, primary tumors, and based on that, you can do the treatment. So gene expression profiling can identify putative tissue of origin, and this is based on the primarily the expression pattern on the various genes that is at the RNA level, and which can be done either by using microarray or RT-PCR assay. And this is in other small term, we all call as GEP. So, and gene expression profiling or GEP fares better as compared to immunohistochemistry for identification of tissue of origin of metastatic tumors. Here, the GEP is showing a better agreement in terms of the primary tumor as compared to the IHC. And similarly, RT-PCR or reverse transcriptase PCR shows better accuracy over the IHC in terms of identifying the tumor primary site. But identifying of the tumor primary site doesn't serve the purpose. Let's see in the next few slides. So if you treat the patient after knowing what is a potential or putative tumor of origin or the tumor site, the overall survival does not change that much. It is still 12.5 months. This is a paper coming from Hensworth et al, where they have used approximately 290 cases and they have used 92 gene reverse transcriptase real-time PCR assay for the cancer classification. Similarly, EpiCup is another method of classifying or identifying the tumor of origin using the CpG island methylation pattern. And over here, they have found that in up to 87%, they can identify the tumor of origin, which is very good. But at the same time, there is no much significant difference in the overall survival. This is a study coming from Hayashi, which have talked about the therapies using the gene expression profiling and comparing with a randomized trial with the carbo and paclitaxel. And what they have found that there is no significant difference, even if we use gene expression profiling with the empirical paclitaxel. So this is the Kaplan-Meier curve. You don't see much of a difference and quite a big significant overlap. Similarly, the study called JASCAP-I04, where the gene expression profiling was compared with the empirical chemotherapy, but this time the empirical chemotherapy was gemcitabine and cisplatin. Again, the outcome was not that significant. You can see overlap of the Kaplan-Meier curve with the median PFS of 4.6 in the GEP guided treatment arm compared to 5.3 months in the chemotherapy arm. So again, the clinical utility of using the gene expression profiling in treating the patient does not yield that significant benefit. Again, if we see the meta-analysis of the PFS associated with the site-specific therapies, what we have found that most of them favors the tailored treatment, but none of them shows a significant, statistically significant difference as compared to the empirical treatment actually. Similarly, for the overall survival, they also favor the tailored treatment, but there is no statistically significant difference as compared to the empirical treatment. Whether it is a non-randomized trial, a meta-analysis, or randomized trial meta-analysis. So it reflects that even if you know that this is the site of origin, you are not able to make a big difference in the outcome. So now the second option comes. Let's have a new perspective to how to treat these cancers. Let's try to do the genomic profiling using the next generation sequencing of the DNA and RNA and identify the driver alterations which are driving the cancers. Primarily the fusions or alterations which can be targeted at using the protein therapies. If you see the identification of a primary site, which is a multi-step process where we use multiple imaging, multiple immunohistochemistry, then lead to a point. On the other hand, if we use a comprehensive genomic profiling, which is a one-step process and identifies the actionable target, so you reach to the whole idea of identifying the potential treatment for the patient. The good part is, most of the carcinoma of unknown primary have clinically relevant genomic alterations. That is very unique about CUP. This is a study coming from Foundation where they have have analyzed adenocarcinoma CUP and non-adenocarcinoma CUP. And what they have found that 85% of the patients will have approximately more than one potentially targetable actionable genomic alteration. And this can have all set of categories, including the base substitutions, indels, amplifications, deletions, and rearrangements. So this is the diversity of the genomic alterations on the comprehensive genomic profiling, the adenocarcinoma versus non-adenocarcinoma cup. You may see a different genomic alteration pattern with different genes which are involved, which is dominated by the p53 in both the cases. But at the same time, the good part is approximately 85 to 90% of the cup may have genomic alterations where we have the drug's potential treatment for them. This is a study coming from Clinic et al, published in Annual Oncology, where they have found that the 88% of the cup may have actionable genomic alterations where we have the drugs available. Most of these drugs are available in the clinical trial setting, and they are drugs which are easily available and approved in that particular subtype, but in carcinoma primary, you can still try. If you see that the majority of these druggable targets lie in the category of BRAF, EGFR, and ERBB2, where we are very confident how to treat these kind of targets, actionable targets, and we know how to predict the outcomes in these treatment options. Patients primarily have in the CUP benefit from the target therapies, and primarily with the clinical trial-based therapies actually, because most of the targetable drugs, actionable targets with the drugs are right now under the clinical trial setting. There's a study coming from MSK Impact where they have analyzed 341 gene NGS and they have seen in 30% of time there is a clinically actionable target and 10% received matched therapy. So they have shown, which is less compared to the foundation, but they have shown at least 10% can be dealt in a different manner. Similarly, a study coming from a prospective precision oncology registry trial called NCT-DKT Master, where they have seen that the patients who are treated using the molecular-based therapy, the PFS2 is better, 243 days mean, as compared to the PFS1 that was the last prior systemic chemotherapy. And up to 60-70% of the patients have a PFS ratio, PFS2 versus by PFS1, or more than 1.3. So it tells that the recommended therapy based on the molecular profiling appears better in terms of the PFS. So now immunotherapy, which will be discussed more by Archana in the next session. But immunotherapy can be also be used as one of the treatment options. But identifying the right signature or biomarker is a little tricky. And this is a study which talks about a non-randomized single-arm phase 2 study where nivolumab was given to CUP. And half of the patient did not respond or progress, and half of them have a partial response or complete responses. And there was quite a good correlation with the increased PD-L1 expression, but this association was not very conclusive. So more biomarkers are needed in terms of identifying the CUP. And if you can see, the median OS is better than what he was with the chemotherapy arm. The interesting part is the NGS or the comprehensive genomic profiling can calculate the tumor mutation burden, and patients who have more than 20 mutation per megabase are considered to be high TMB. High TMB is normally seen in up to 10% of the carcinoma from the primary, and another biomarker called MSI is seen in 1.6% of the carcinoma from the primary. Taken together, these two subsets, the TMB high and MSI high, is up to 12% and are eligible for immunotherapy. And you can expect very good responses beyond the PD-L1 expression as one of the biomarkers. So doing NGS on the tissue is what we have discussed, but the molecular profiling using a liquid biopsy is also feasible. If you use liquid biopsy and cell-free DNA analysis of CUP, there is quite a good concordance, as well as there are studies which talks about that up to 90% of the CUP patients may show actionable targets, more than one actionable target in the liquid biopsy. And they have level 1 and level 2 evidence of the actionable drugs. And primarily you can see PIK3, HER2, BRCA, and BRAF, which have the level 1 evidence of the actionable drugs, identified in up to 1 and up to 1/5 of the patients actually. So this is a very good opportunity and a single step method to identify the actionable potential drug for the carcinoma non primary. Various trials are being focused on CUP as of now, primarily found based on the genome expression profiling as well as genomic profiling. So the important one is the super coming from Australian starting 2013 and the foundation one starting 2015. Few of them are based on the gene expression profiling and few of them are coming up with the immunotherapy protocols for CUP. This new trial called CAPESCO is something which I wanted to share with everybody. This is our ongoing trial, which is an international trial with 34 countries and 141 sites and 790 patients to be planned. And the whole idea is to do the NGS using foundation and a molecular tumor board is going to advise the molecular guided therapy. And then the evaluation has to be done at the end. This is a phase 2 randomized controlled trial, multicentric. So the key message for today's talk is classification of CUP is really difficult and treatment options are quite limited. Molecular testing, including gene expression profiling and genomic profiling are the way forward to treat the CUP in a specific manner. With that, I thank you all for your kind attention and you can post your questions in the chat box.
Thank you, Dr. Amit.
Yes.
I will now be talking about precision medicine in CUP, predominantly focusing on tumor mutational burden. I will go over the main issues with TMB calculations, methods, and standardization of TMB values between labs. In the end, I will talk about liquid biopsy and TMB measurement, if these immune markers are useful in CUP, and about mutational signatures and the Caris genomic prevalence score. This is just a brief overview of what TMB actually calculates. It looks at the non-synonymous mutations in exons. It is often reported as the number of mutations per megabase for solid tumors. It's important to note here that TMB is a continuous variable and it does not follow a linear distribution pattern. TMB is no longer an emerging immunotherapy biomarker. FDA granted approval to pembrolizumab for the treatment of adult and pediatric patients with TMB high cutoff of 10 or more than 10 mutations per megabase to treat unresectable or metastatic solid tumors that are either not responding to therapy or do not have a satisfactory treatment option available. This places the calculation and reporting of TMB accurately at the forefront of immuno-oncology. There are several factors that affect TMB measurement, and the lack of standardization between various labs adds to the discrepancies. One important factor is the method of TMB calculation. For most studies to date demonstrating an association between TMB and clinical benefit, TMB was measured by whole exome sequencing on matched tumor normal samples. Whole exome sequencing covers the coding regions of all 22,000 genes, which is about 180,000 exons, equivalent to 30 megabases, making up around 1% of the genome, and it encompasses most of the known disease-causing variants. Because most initial studies were done using whole exome sequencing, it is regarded as the gold standard for calculating TMB. However, it is challenging to routinely implement whole exome in a clinical setting because this method typically requires complex analysis and a matched normal sample for germline comparison. For these reasons, targeted gene panels are being developed as an alternative method to whole exome sequencing. However, these gene panels are also subject to pitfalls and inaccuracies. Almost any factor that affects sequencing can also affect TMB results. The coverage of the gene panel is extremely important for TMB calculations. Germline mutations are not included in TMB because the immune system has a higher likelihood of recognizing these alterations as normal, and these then need to be eliminated by robust bioinformatics platforms. Targeted gene panels are developed to specifically target recurrently mutated regions. It is probably best to exclude these recurrent mutations and truncation tumor suppressor gene mutations to avoid overestimating TMB. The next few slides highlight the in silico and empirical TMB estimation using whole exome sequencing mutations from the TCGA datasets. And this was done to determine the capability of TMB estimation from gene panels. Panel design majorly influences TMB measurement, as this paper shows. Amplicons of arbitrary sequencing panels are schematically depicted here to illustrate differences in size and composition. Panel one is a small focused panel, which might be used for entity-specific investigations or when the DNA is limited, like in liquid biopsy. Panels two and three are more comprehensive and they target additional exonic regions. Panel four is a comprehensive tumor profiling panel for TMB detection. This paper shows the precision associated with specific panel sizes in terms of confidence intervals using panels of 0.1 to 10 megabase in size. In this display, the precision of TMB estimation, which is reported at 95% confidence interval, is illustrated in a tumor with high TMB of 20 mutations per megabase and a tumor with low TMB of 5 mutations per megabase. As we can see, sequencing panels larger than 1 megabase are required to separate these tumors with high precision. It is also important to consider whether the specific gene sequences in a panel have an impact on the TMB result. Panels targeted to specific cancer-related genes may introduce unwanted bias into the area of the genome that's been covered. But if the panel is sufficiently large, then the function of specific genes within it would be negligible, and then they should not impact TMB assessment. Driver mutations in BRCA1, TP53, and POL are associated with large increases in tumor mutational burden, and these should always be assessed alongside TMB. These graphs are shown to depict mutational load predictions with different panel tests in both matched and unmatched samples. The panels shown here are a large 300 gene panel, a medium 48 gene panel, and a small 15 gene panel. The x-axis represents whole exome sequencing, and y-axis represents targeted gene panel sequencing. The linear regression line here is shown in black, with 95% confidence bands, which are shaded in gray. This red dashed line is the identity line, which is shown here for comparison. Large mutational loads correlated strongly with whole exome sequencing-based mutational load, regardless of whether they were matched or unmatched. As we can see here, the R-square was 0.99 and 0.93, with a p-value of less than 0.001. The ability of medium gene panels to predict the whole exome sequencing mutational load was somewhat reduced, with an R-square value of 0.84 for matched and 0.71 for unmatched samples. And small panels were really poor indicators of the overall mutational load. Thus, the large matched or unmatched panels both successfully recapitulated the whole exome sequencing mutational load. Another paper here describes the precision of TMB estimation at different TMB levels. They performed comprehensive genomic profiling and whole exome sequencing on the same biopsy specimen for a cohort of 29 samples. For each sample, they then measured the percentage deviation from the whole exome tumor mutational burden. They found that the percentage deviation is lower for higher underlying TMB, meaning that specimens with high TMB can be effectively identified by targeted sequencing of several hundred genes. In contrast, this percent deviation for intermediate and low levels of TMB started to increase, especially with less than 0.5 megabases sequenced. In summary, the general consensus is that sequencing at least 300 genes, which corresponds to around 1 megabase of exonic sequence, provides fairly accurate TMB, which is comparable to whole exome sequencing TMB results. This is not an official consensus, but it's a reasonable guide. Ideally, gene panel should be more than 0.8 megabase for reliable TMB detection. And TMB estimation is less accurate at lower TMB levels. Along with panel size, another important predictor of TMB assessment is variant calling. TMB assessment by whole exome sequencing or gene panels commonly includes non-synonymous somatic tumor mutations, but these may be restricted to missense mutations only. For whole exome sequencing, paired sample mutation calling is typically performed on tumor samples as well as matched germline control samples. Somatic mutations can also be inferred in tumors without matched controls in silico from databases of known polymorphisms or from variant data in tissue from different patients. So some assays actually filter the potential germline mutations out, and this identifies the origin of the mutation. Although these approaches do simplify the TMB assessment workflow, they may result in false positives and higher TMB levels, particularly in patients with ethnic backgrounds like our Indian population that are less well represented in reference databases which are commonly used. These effects ultimately may be negligible for TMB assessment by whole exome or large gene panels, but they're definitely increased if smaller gene panels are used. Around 45% of variants that give rise to neoantigens are subclonal. So these will have a lower variant allele frequency and they may be difficult to detect among clonal variants. A 5% variant allele frequency limit of detection is needed to distinguish between the two. Those with elevated clonal neoantigen loads and little subclonal heterogeneity are usually overrepresented in groups of patients who are benefiting from IO therapy. TMB reporting has been all over the place in the last few years. Labs usually report TMB as high or low values based on cutoffs developed during their validations, and these cutoffs can change over time as testing increases. These cutoffs were initially defined retrospectively, and TMB of 10 or more than 10 mutations per megabase is now the only established cutoff to date for enhanced immunotherapy response. Identifying a single fixed TMB threshold that could be applicable across different tumors may be difficult because the median number of somatic mutation differs across different tumors and tumor types. Tumors such as pilocytic astrocytoma and ALL have low mutational loads, whereas non-small cell lung and melanoma have high mutational loads. Non-small cell lung cancer and melanoma are mainly caused by exogenous agents, and because they have high mutational loads, an accurate TMB prediction is possible even with a small gene panel of say 170 genes. Given these variations in tumor mutation loads based on tumor type, the best way to report TMB would be to report it in the context of the specific tumor type. For example, the report should include the median TMB assessed by the lab for that tumor type with the median TMB assessment for all patients. So this then provides an overview of where the patient actually is. And the median, of course, should be updated daily or whenever cases are run because it will change over time. It is best not to compare the lab median with the TCGA data set TMB median and include that in reports. Another way that labs have been reporting TMB is by defining quartiles. A graphical representation of the distribution and median for that specific tumor type would ideally be most useful for clinicians. So labs can differ in their methodologies, in the number of genes they include in their panels, the types of mutations they include to calculate tumor mutation burdens, and the recommendation for interpretation of results using bioinformatics pipelines. Since there is a variety of alternative approaches now available, standardization is required as TMB's assays are moving into clinical practice, especially after FDA approval of this biomarker. It is essential to raise awareness of all assay considerations to ensure that reliable and accurate TMB assessments can be achieved and compared across studies. To do this, there are two main efforts that have been underway since the last few years. One is the Friends of Cancer Research, which is based in the US, and the other is QIP, which is based in Germany. Several labs across the world are participating in these harmonization initiatives. The Friends of Cancer Research will soon release a TMB calibration tool that labs can use to correct the variability in TMB calculations across gene panels and pipelines. Earlier this year, FOCR released a statement regarding their early phase results. They observed variability across different gene panels, suggesting that panel size, panel composition, bioinformatics algorithms, including the types of mutations and variant filters used, were all contributing to differences in TMB measurement. They will elaborate on these and report on these in the next few months. CARES has been a part of the FOCR harmonization project, and it has updated its TMB high threshold to reflect greater than or equal to 10 mutations per megabase across all solid tumor types, aligning the test results to pembrolizumab for TMB high cases. Coming to immunotherapy in CUP specifically, this Venn diagram here shows the relationship between the three immunotherapy markers for all cancer types. The relationship between tumor mutational burden, MSI, and PD-L1 was explored by analyzing 11,000 cases that had results for all three assays. In this set, the overall rate of MSI high was 3%. Overall high TMB was 7.7%, and PD-L1 positivity was 25.4%. Among MSI high cases, 70% were also TMB high. But among high TMB cases, 27% were MSI high. Only 0.6% of the cases were positive for all three markers, while 69.5% of cases were negative for all three. And out of these total cohorts of samples, only 26% of MSI high cases were PD-L1 positive, compared to 44% of high TMB cases. Several papers have been published and they have come to the consensus that TMB and PD-L1 are independent and are similarly predictive of response to immunotherapy. The majority of mismatch repair deficient MSI high tumors also show TMB high, but the reverse is not true. A similar study was also carried out for CUP tumors. This is a Venn diagram showing the relationship between TMB high, MSI high, and PD-L1 positivity in CUP cases. 300 CUP cases were analyzed for all three of these predictive biomarkers. Out of these, 103 cases had at least one of the three predictive biomarkers to immune checkpoint blockade, and 259 CUP cases were negative for all three biomarkers. They also compared the status of predictive biomarkers for immune checkpoint inhibitors in CUP with the four common cancer types that have FDA-approved immune checkpoint treatment modalities, which are melanoma, non-small cell lung, urothelial cancer, renal cell carcinoma. They found that TMB high was found in 12% of CUP, PD-L1 positivity in 22% of CUP cases, and 1.8% of CUP cases had MSI high. In summary, when presence of any one of the three biomarkers was taken into account, 28% of CUP cases were potentially eligible for treatment with immune checkpoint inhibitors, and this provides a novel treatment option in patients with CUP. Coming to the role of liquid biopsy in TMB measurement, plasma TMB measurements may have advantages over tissue biopsy in the follow-up of early responses to immunotherapy because of the ease and speed of obtaining these samples. Plasma TMB assays have been developed and validated, and efforts are ongoing for harmonization with TMB data from tissue samples. One such study shown here sent replicate sets of 20 metastatic castration-resistant prostate cancer samples to two labs that carried out plasma-based NGS assays. They also collected matching tissue samples from each of these subjects within 12 months of plasma collections, and these tissue samples were analyzed by whole exome sequencing. Comparison of the TMB measured by whole exome sequencing in tissue biopsies and TMB measured by ctDNA obtained in streck tubes by the two labs showed that in figures A and C, there is high correlation with an R-square of 0.9, between plasma and tissue TMB for high TMB levels. Figures B and D, they show that the correlation for low and medium TMB samples was not as high as high TMB levels, with an R square of 0.1. Such a similar correlation was also shown by another paper where they demonstrated it in tissue-based assays using the TCGA data set. Figures E and F here show that the two plasma-based assays are highly correlated, even for biopsy samples with low medium TMB. And this suggests that the low concordance between tissue and blood for low TMB samples may be more likely the biological factor rather than a technical factor. Given the biological difference between plasma and tissue and the magnitude of sequencing depth differences between the two assays, a good correlation between tissue whole exome sequencing and plasma assays may not necessarily be expected. The study suggests that clinical validity of plasma TMB and tissue TMB in immunotherapy should ideally be evaluated independently. Clinical and research applications of liquid biopsy in cup are wide-reaching, as we can see from this figure. This is a summary of all the research in liquid biopsy for cups. Studies are using cfDNA, ctDNA, as well as ctCs for cup. This table is to show a summary of these studies. Only one group has used patient cell-free DNA to profile the mutational landscape of cup tumors. Evaluating 442 patients with target sequencing of 54,000 genes, they found that 80% of patients harbored at least one genetic alteration. The mutational profile was comparable to studies profiling cup tumor tissue and demonstrated heterogeneity similar to that seen across all tumor types. In one patient, serial on-treatment ctDNA samples demonstrated dynamic changes in the mutation profile, which were consistent with response and then resistance to treatment. So this indicates the feasibility of using ctDNA to not only profile tumors, but also to track resistance mechanisms while they are on treatment. The most recent publication evaluated 10 CUP patients and found CTCs in 50% of cases, with a median CTC count of 31. CTCs were seen more frequently in treatment-naive patients, and in one patient, CTC levels decreased with treatment. There are also new approaches to improve the recovery and detection of CUP CTCs that may have lost their epithelial markers. Isolation of CTCs has the further advantage of allowing functional analysis of single tumor cells. So this includes doing whole genome sequencing, gene expression profiling, epigenetic studies, and proteomics. CUP tumors are tumors without histological definition, and therefore they're difficult to classify molecularly. In addition, multiple metastatic deposits commonly observed in patients with CUP are likely to increase ctDNA heterogeneity. CUP tumors that have lost their obvious molecular signposts to the tissue of origin, this makes CTC phenotyping unlikely to be helpful in such cases. So although research in this area is very exciting, utility of any of these methods remains to be seen with regards to determining the tissue of origin in patients with CUP. Coming to mutational signatures and their utility in CUP. Mutational signatures are characteristic combinations of mutation types. These arise from specific mutagenesis processes. This is an older version of mutational signatures, which was put out by COSPIC. There is now a newer version out this June. And in the newer version, mutational signatures are divided into single base substitutions, doublet substitutions, and indels. These mutagenic processes that produce mutational signatures can be UV exposure, DNA replication infidelity, genotoxins, which are both exogenous as well as endogenous, and defective DNA repair pathways. Signatures that can be associated with high TMB levels are MMR deficiency, UV light exposure, smoking exposure, and mutations in the exonuclease domain of POL. These mutations can cause either a hypermutator phenotype, which is more than 10 mutations per megabase, or an ultramutator phenotype, which is more than 100 mutations per megabase. This is an example of four signatures from COSMIC database that are associated with defective MMR. Mutational processes are linked to treatment selection via mutational signatures. So mutational signatures in tumor genomes can actually reflect the activity of specific mutational processes, and then this can help in providing support for therapy selection. Different types of mutational signatures can be considered, such as base substitutions, which are here in orange, indel signatures in green, and rearrangement signatures in yellow. The diagnostic interpretation of characteristic signatures can contribute to therapy choice by either including therapy, which is seen in the green boxes, or excluding therapy, such as the red box. Actionable pathways can be identified by mutational signatures, such as these, which mainly include DNA repair defects. And these can be confirmed by pathogenic mutations in the genes which are indicated in these pathways. Caris has launched its mutational signature analysis platform, which is the genomic prevalence score. This uses an artificial intelligence-driven machine learning algorithm to compare molecular characteristics of a patient's tumor with the extensive database that Caris has. This helps with providing information about CUP, about cases with atypical presentations, and also cases that are ambiguous. Caris presented this data at ASCO last year, showing that its algorithm classified tumors from over 55,000 samples with over 95% confidence, and helped with cases with ambiguity about tissue of origin. The Caris molecular artificial intelligence analyzes historical, clinical, and outcome data and learns from the past to provide for a better future via molecular subtyping. This is the paper that they presented last year. And this is how the report is presented, with a probability score of a match with its database for the sample sent to them. In summary, recent clinical evidence and FDA approval has strengthened the significance of TMB-high as a biomarker of response, and hence it's a rational target for immunotherapy in all tumors as well as CUP. TMB standardization guidelines will help molecular labs to implement the biomarker for routine clinical use. CUP remains an unmet clinical and research need, and predictive biomarkers could provide novel therapy options in CUP. Thank you for your patient listening. And I think we can be ready for questions now.
So the question from Kanchan is, what is the correct approach to diagnose the CUP? Means what technology, IHC or NGS? Dr. Amit?
Yeah, so Kanchan, the idea of diagnosing the primary site of the CUP is primarily based on the IHC and the gene expression profiling. NGS is used to not identify the primary site, but it is used to identify the actionable driver alteration. So it is NGS is primarily meant for the treatment, and IHC is primarily meant for the diagnosis of the primary site. So your question have two parts. So if I am able to answer your question correctly, you can just say hi on the chat or yes on the chat.
I think the question is answered. So what are the chances of targeted treatment in CUP apart from lung or breast, as it found in other solid tumors as well?
So I think we have to rephrase the question once again. Yeah. When we are saying it is carcinoma fundum family, we are not sure whether it is lung cancer or breast cancer or any other cancer. The probability of the lung cancer or breast cancer, if you presume that they are coming from them, is definitely high because of the prevalence of these cancers across the globe. But what we have seen that the most of the CUP tend to get diagnosed either coming from pancreas or gastric or lymphoma. So I think the chances of treating them with the target therapy is it all depends where is the true primary coming from. But as we have discussed, by using the NGS approach, up to 85 to 90% time, whether tissue biopsy or liquid biopsy, will give you some actionable target, actionable genomic alteration, where you can use the target treatment.
Correct. So I think these are the questions which have been asked. So thanks to Dr. Amit and Dr. Archana. While we are coming to an end of this wonderful session we have with our doctors, I would like to take this opportunity to discuss a unique initiative by the GeneEvolve. So GeneWise is a digital academic platform to share and collaborate, discuss academic information related to the field of genetics. This can be from oncology, neurogenomics, or tests related to pre- and postnatal genetic testing. To associate with this initiative, I invite all of you to share your clinical case studies, academic blogs, write-ups, video bites, which can help to gain more knowledge that is decoding the genetics. We will be featuring these articles along with the doctor's profile on wide digital network of Dr. Lal Path Labs. So if you are interested, do write to us at geneevolve@lalpathlabs.com. Next slide. So just to ensure that we are the partners with Caris, and we are the only distributor of theirs in India. So if there is anybody who wants to send the samples for Caris, you kindly approach us for sending the samples. Next slide. As far as our accreditations are concerned, we are CAP certified, NABL certified, and ISO certifications are also there. Next slide. So GeneEvolve brings the dawn of new era of genomic testing. Thanks to all this, to the speakers and all the participants. The recording of this session will be available on LinkedIn and Facebook site. Thanks a lot, Dr. Amit and Dr. Archana once again. We will now close this session and look forward to many more such fruitful sessions.
Thank you. Thank you all. Yeah.
Thanks a lot.